Okay, good afternoon, everyone. And it's my great pleasure and honor to have Professor Tova Milo here to give a talk on managing general and individual knowledge in cloud mining applications. Before Professor Tova Milo to deliver her excellent speech, and let me give a brief introduction about Professor Milo. And Professor Milo received her PhD in computer science from Hebrew University, Jerusalem, in 1992. She then worked in the area, you know, everybody knows it's a famous research lab in Paris and France, and the University of Toronto, before returning to Israel in 1995. Professor Milo joined the School of Computer Science at Tel Aviv University in 1995. Now she is a professor there and the head of a database research group and holds the chair of the information management. Professor Milo's research focuses on the advanced database applications such as data integration, XML, semi-structured information, data center business process, and crowdsourcing, and studying both theoretical and practical aspects. Professor Milo served in the programming committee for several international conferences and a member of VLDB endowment, and SCDT is the Serial Database Conference and Executive Board. She also served as the chair of PAUSE Executive Committee member and the editor of TOS and Logical Method in Computer Science Journal. She received grants from various Israel Science Foundation, US Israel, by National Science Foundation, the Israel and French Ministry of Science and European Union. She was elected Fellow of ACM and a member of Academic European and a recipient of 2010 ACM PAUSE Alberta Mendelssohn Test Time Award. So without further delay, please join me to welcome Professor Milo.
So this is a very long title for the talk. There are many things that maybe you don't understand what I mean, and in particular, what is general and individual knowledge and what is crowd mining. But I will spend the next hour or so explaining that and why I think it's important. So this is a big data lecture series, so I'm sure you've heard a lot about big data and all the data that is exploding in the world, all types of data, very useful, very important. And I'm sure you also know that the data by itself is not so interesting. What is interesting is actually the potential, right? The knowledge and the stuff that we can get out of the data, okay? And that should give us advantages in all sorts of fields, economics, science, medicine, et cetera, I'm sure I haven't said anything until now that you don't know, right? So everybody in this area is trying to study how you actually represent this knowledge, how you find this knowledge, how you integrate this knowledge, how you process it efficiently. And I want to focus today on, in all this huge world of big data, on one particular type of big data, which is the data that sits in people's heads. Okay, your head, my head, everybody in the world's head. And I would like to argue that this data, this knowledge that we have, okay, that is sometimes not written anywhere, is no less important than all the big data that people are collecting. And it would be useful if we manage actually to use it, just like we use the standard big data. And so the typical way that people use people's knowledge and things like that is through a very active area which is called crowdsourcing. I think I see a few faces here that work on that, so they know what crowdsourcing is, but still for the other ones that perhaps are not that familiar. So some forms of crowdsourcing I'm sure you know and you use every day. I'm sure everybody's using Wikipedia. Is there anyone that has never used Wikipedia? I don't think so. What about TripAdvisor? Is there anyone that never, ever used TripAdvisor? One. Okay, but that's not very common. Okay, you don't travel much, right? Okay, but what about Galaxy Zoo? How many people know what Galaxy Zoo is? Nobody. Okay, so here's an example of crowdsourcing application that you don't know. Actually, it's a very cool game. It's one of the favorite computer games of my children. So the game works as follows. There are pictures that are taken by the Hubble telescope. And the players of this computer game, the game shows them pictures of galaxies, and it asks them questions. Is this galaxy oval? Is it round? Is it bright? And so on. Lots of questions about the galaxies, and they have to answer extremely fast, and they get points for answering the questions. And there is the winner of the day, and the winner of the month, and the smartest person, et cetera, et cetera. And my children can spend hours and hours on that. So you may wonder, what does this have to do with crowdsourcing? Okay. So the point is that behind the screen, okay, what actually this game is doing is taking all the answers that people have answered for questions about galaxies, and it's building a huge database where galaxies are tagged and with properties. Okay, so this picture of galaxy, this galaxy is round and bright and et cetera, et cetera. And then people can use this big database, actually researchers that do research on galaxies, et cetera, can use this database in order to find the galaxies that they're interested in, the properties, to do statistics, et cetera. So that's kind of a crowdsourcing application where the people don't even know that they're giving you information. They just play a game, they're having fun, and they contribute information. Okay. Another kind of game is Foldit. Who heard about Foldit? That's Okay, so some people heard about it. So Foldit is another game. What it does is it shows you three-dimensional pictures of proteins, okay? And what it asks the players to do is to find folding for the proteins. So apparently folding of proteins is a way to find regularity in the structure of the protein, and it's very useful for understanding how the protein works, etc. Now, this is a task that it's very hard for a computer to do. It's an NP-complete problem to find the folding of proteins, but apparently when people play in it, somehow people have this three-dimensional capability of viewing the thing and finding a folding in a very fast way. And actually, this was on the front page of the New York Times like a year ago, something like that, because the players of this game managed to find the folding of the a protein that is related to the HIV disease that was not known before and has some hope in helping understanding better the disease. So Foldit actually takes a problem which is NP hard for computers, and it uses people as processors to solve this problem. Now, if you think about Galaxy Zoo, it's not very different because you can computers know today how to take a picture of a galaxy and process it and analyze it and see whether the galaxy is oval or round or bright or whatever. But it takes a lot of computational efforts to do that. While my children, when they look at a picture, in a split second, they can say this is oval, this is round, etc. So what we're doing here is actually trying to use people to do some processing or to do some things that maybe computers could do if they work really, really hard, but we want to do it much more efficiently and exploit people. So in general, we have two types of applications that are useful for crowdsourcing. One is like Galaxy Zoo and Foldit, where computers could in principle do it, but it would be expensive and maybe not accurate enough. And the other type of applications is like Wikipedia and TripAdvisor, for instance, is where computers don't have the knowledge. Okay, so you actually have to use people to bring the knowledge. It's not just doing the computation, but actually bring the data in, put it in, and say what they think about it. And but in all these applications that I showed you until now, one property of these applications is that the questions that you ask the crowd were very specific. Okay, you would ask the crowd, is this galaxy round? You knew exactly what you want from the people. Or for instance, you wanted to ask them, is this hotel good or bad? Okay, there is a particular question that you want the crowd to answer. What I'm trying to argue in this talk, and hopefully I'll convince you until the end, is that actually there's much more that you can do with people. And in fact, you can think about human knowledge as an open world. There's lots of things that sit in our heads. And I cannot extract it because I don't even know what to ask you. Okay, I don't know what questions or what knowledge you have, and therefore I don't know what are the right questions or what even is the domain of questions that I can extract stuff from you. So in principle, what we're trying to do in this project that I will tell you about is really try to find what kind of interesting and important patterns of information people have and in certain domain areas, and we can extract and use them. So I'll just give you two examples. I'll give you more examples afterwards, but think about healthcare, okay? So you go to the doctor. The doctor examines you and gives you some prescription or whatever. And suppose even that the doctor, when you go there, types everything inside the computer, okay, what you said, whether you have a headache or this or this or this, what medicine they gave you, everything is recorded, okay? But still, there's lots of stuff that is not recorded anywhere. So, for instance, when he told you to take this pill, did you take it? Or did you take it at the right time? Or did you have coffee before or after you took the medicine? Okay, and what other things, non-traditional medicine, for instance, you use at home that is not prescribed by the doctor, and also what's not written often in the computer is the doctor's intuition. When they looked at you, why did they decide to give you this pill and not this pill? Okay, so all this information, which is very important if you want to try to understand or to analyze health data, is not written anywhere. And it would be great if I could somehow extract this from people's mind. The same for finance, okay? So again, you can think about your bank account. So everything is written there, you think, right? How much money you earn, every time that you go to the ATM to take some money, when you buy something, you sell something, everything is written there. Well, not everything, because when you take money from the ATM, cash, how the bank doesn't know what you did with the cash, right? Whether you spent it on that, or other things. Or why did you use this ATM and not another one? Okay, or why did you use to spend that much money and not that much money? And the people that give you consulting in the bank, why they told you this and not that? So again, there's tons of financial information that is not recorded anywhere except in people's mind. And again, if we want to do some financial analysis, it would be great if we can use it. So what we'll try to do is try to understand what kind of questions or how do we know what kind of information, interesting information to extract from you and with what kind of questions, okay? So let's play a game, okay? Or let's think about, forget people, and let's just go back to classical databases, okay? So in classical databases, actually, many years ago, we had the same problem, okay? There were tons of data, and we didn't know. We wanted to understand what's interesting in the data, and we didn't know what queries to ask about the data. Okay, think about a big supermarket, okay? It records all the transactions, everything that people buy and sell, buy and how they pay, et cetera, et cetera. There's a huge database. And how do you know what's interesting there? Okay, so actually this started the whole field of data mining in databases, and they developed algorithms actually to mine the database and to try to find what interesting patterns there are there. So the typical example for data mining applications is that when you mine the data, the database of a supermarket, you find that people that buy diapers typically also buy beer. Okay, so that's like a common phenomena, at least in American supermarkets. And that can be used by the owner of the supermarket. Either they will put the beer and the diapers one next to the other so that it will be convenient for people to buy the two together, or actually maybe they want to put it in two sides of the supermarket so that whoever buy diapers have to traverse the whole supermarket until they get to the beer, and therefore they will see more things on the way and maybe will buy some more stuff, okay? So what I would like to do, or what we would like to do, is actually try to do data mining, but on people's heads, okay? On the information that you have in your head, and try to extract from there something interesting, okay? So the question is it possible to mine the crowd using algorithms or techniques that are taken from data mining? Okay, so let's try, okay? So let's model my head, your head, your brain, as a database, a small database, okay? So for instance, my database records every time that I was sick, what did I do? Okay, so for instance, when I had a sore throat, I treated it with garlic and oregano leaves. Okay, and then another time I treated sore throat and low fever with garlic and ginger. And then another time I treated heartburn with water, et cetera, et cetera. So this, my head, kind of as a database, records everything that happened to me and what I did. Okay, so in principle, if I could extract everything that is in my head and put it on a disk and go to each one of you and extract everything that you have, all the illnesses that you had, how you treated them, etc., and put them on the disk, I could run a standard data mining algorithm on it, and we're done, okay? But the point is that it's not really possible. If I ask any of you, can you tell me, over the last year, all the times that you were sick, and how exactly did you treat your illness when you were sick? Can someone tell me that? Does anyone remember? Yes? No? Someone? Nobody? Okay, so you're not very strange. I mean, nobody remembers, okay? Actually, there are social studies that show that people don't remember details. They cannot really remember, they cannot really give you all the details of things. What people do remember is only some sort of summaries of the information, okay? It's like the association rules, like the it's as if they already mine their own brain and remember the patterns that exist there. So for instance, someone can tell you, to treat sore throat, I often use garlic. He will not remember all the times that he did that, but that's kind of a summary of the information that people can give you, okay? So what we're going to do is actually to use this kind of patterns that you do remember in order to mine the information that you have stored in your brain. And we'll do it using two types of questions, okay? The first one we call open questions. And this is really like very general question. It's like, tell me something interesting, okay? So for instance, I'll ask something like, tell me about some illness and how you treat it, okay? So an answer could be, I typically treat nausea with ginger infusion, okay? But the thing is that when you ask people these kind of open questions, they will give you as answer a pattern, but it will be a very simple one, okay? Like in this case, nausea and ginger, and that's it, okay? It's like very, very simple thing. They don't remember like spontaneously to give you complicated things, even if they know them, okay? So what we're going to do in order to dig better and deeper into people's brains is we need to ask them very concrete questions. They could be more complicated, but they have to be very concrete. So for instance, suppose I learned that people have nausea and that people sometimes have headache and there is this thing that is called ginger infusion. By asking open questions, I learned a little bit about the domain, then I can compose more complicated queries. For instance, when you have both nausea and fever, how often do you use ginger infusion? Okay, or even more complicated, how many times when you have this and this and this and this, how much do you do that? And things that are much more complicated. And what we'll need to do is actually to use these two kinds of questions interleavingly, The first one will help us to explore the domain, and the other one will help us to be more concrete and learn more about things. And I'll explain how we do that in a second. So just to give you an idea of the kind of problems that we will have to deal with while we try to mine people's information. So first of all, as I said before, we will need to understand what questions to ask exactly, whether they should be open or closed, what kind of things exactly. We will need to understand how to determine the correctness, okay, and the importance of the answers that we get, because people may answer different things. Sometimes they are correct, sometimes they are not. We'll try to understand that. And no less importantly, we will have to figure out who should we ask, okay? Who are the right people to ask the questions, and how many people should we ask each question? And typically you have like a limited budget, okay? Either because my kids, when they play the game, okay, this one that tags galaxies, I don't let them play all day, right? So in the half an hour that they play, the game should get the best information out of them. So we should select very carefully the questions so that the people that answer us will use them to the best possible. So we'll try to talk about all these things. I'm already warning you that this is going to be a very high level talk. I'll just give you the principles of things, and there's a long list of technical papers that on each topic that we've written, and if you're interested in one particular topic, I can point you to the right paper. So before I continue, I want to give you a few more examples just so that you see that this thing of mining information and using the crowd and combining the information that I get from the crowd with information that I already have in the database is something that is useful for many domains. So let's think about traveling. Okay, suppose that Anne is going to New York with her kids, and she wants to figure out what to do with them. Okay, so she wants to find a nice place to go with the kids and some activities to do there. And then after they're done, she wants to go to a nice restaurant with the kids. Okay, so what kind of answers, for instance, would be good answer to Anne's questions? So for instance, she would like to know, for instance, that she can go play baseball in Central Park and then eat at Mo's Vegetarian afterwards. And then maybe some additional information, like for instance, someone can tell her, okay, but if you want to go play baseball in the park, you should apply for a permit before you do that. Okay, so note that this thing is not something that Anne was asking about, because she didn't know that there is baseball in the park, and she didn't know that even someone may need permit. Okay, so she didn't ask, do I need a permit? Because she didn't know. Okay, so that was a very general question, and the answer here is more than what she asked. But it's an important, the pieces that were added are important. Okay, or for instance, someone can tell her, okay, go visit the Bronx Zoo and eat at the Pine restaurant. And if you do that, then you should order antipasti at Pine, but don't eat dessert there. Go skip dessert and go have ice cream at the other side of the street. So again, she didn't ask about antipasti. She didn't ask about ice cream, but this is relevant information. Okay, so if you look at the question and the answers, you will see two things there. Okay, so some of the things that she was asking about are things that actually exist in a repository. Okay, for instance, what is the list of restaurants in New York? You can find it in the database. What attractions you have in New York? Also, you can find it in a database. What activities there are in New York? Again, you can find all these things in the database. Okay, so these are like general information that you can find in a regular database. On the other hand, understanding what's a child-friendly attraction, okay, this is subjective. This is things that people can tell you, okay? Or what is a good restaurant? Again, this is something that is not subjective, it's individual knowledge. Okay, people can recommend or not. And the same for additional advice. Okay, so this is something that you would like people to give you information for it. So somehow in this question, there are two types of information. Okay, there is general information that you can find in a regular database. Okay, and there is individual knowledge or opinion that you would like to get from people. So let's look at another example. So suppose I'm a dietitian and I want to study the culinary preferences in some population, and I want to focus on food dishes that are rich in fiber. Okay, that's a complicated research that I want to do. And again, if you look at this question, okay, there are two types of information there. I can find what are the food dishes that are rich in fiber. This is something objective, okay? You can go and check in a database and find it. On the other hand, if you want to know what are the culinary preferences of people, okay, so again, this is individual information and you would like to get it from the crowd, okay? So what we will try to do actually is to focus on these two types of information. And in general, I would argue that almost in any question that you care about, okay, there's two types of information that you want to use, okay, or that you need in order to answer your question. The first is something which I call general knowledge, okay, which is like the geographical location of things, the things that you can find in a regular database, okay, they're kind of objective, okay? And on the other hand, there is individual knowledge. It's the opinions of people, the preferences of people, the habits of people, etc. And you would like to combine these two somehow in order to answer good questions. But one should understand that, I'm saying this sits in the database and this you get from people, it's not completely accurate, okay? Because in principle, your database may be missing some information, and then even though it's an objective thing, it's the location of a place, you could get it from the crowd, okay? So you may want to use people to complete your general information. And on the other hand, again, opinions of people, also, maybe you have them in a database. Okay, you go to TripAdvisor, they are listed there already. You don't have to ask people again unless you want fresh opinions. Okay, so this dichotomy, this separation between general and individual knowledge, it's not by what you get from the crowd and what not, but more by what is somehow objective, or, you know, there's general truth to it, and what is subjective. Okay, it's opinion, preferences, and things like that. And again, I would like a system that will be able to answer queries that deal with these two types of information. Okay, so how is it going to work? Okay, so I will have some database. Okay, that's an ontology, which is the data model that we're using in our work, but I'll go into a little bit more into details about that. But that's where I store my general information. Okay, the fact that there is a city called New York, that there is the Bronx Zoo is inside New York, all these are the restaurants in New York, etc., etc. That's my database. Okay, and then what I would like to do is, given some question or mining task, some question of the crowd, what I would like to do is kind of explore this knowledge base, okay, and find relevant pieces, okay? And then, so for instance, I can find that that's just the syntax for the information in the ontology, but that's not very important. So for instance, I can find in the database that ball game is something that people play in Central Park, okay? Or it's possible to play a ball game in Central Park. So this is something that I found in my database. It's a general truth, okay? And then, based on the information that I find on the database, I will create open and closed questions that I will ask to the crowd. So for instance, I may want to ask them, how often do you play ball games in Central Park? Or which ball games do you play there? And what else do you do when you do there? Okay, these are closed questions and these are open questions on the other side, okay? And I will get some information from the crowd and I will need to evaluate whether this is good or bad information, like how what score should I give to this information? Is it reliable or is it not? And then again, using the patterns that I decided that are important, I may go and explore more complicated patterns. So for instance, not only that you play a ball game, but maybe you want to also get a permit, etc., etc. Okay? And based on these things, I will eventually produce a concise answer, a useful answer to the user, like the one that we saw before. Okay? So up till now, I just told you what I want to do. The question is, how do I do that? Okay, so what are the really difficulties, or what are the things, the ingredients in my system that I will need in order to do that? Okay, so first of all, there was the user request. Okay, I will need, since I'm working with databases and I want to do something automated, I will need to take the user request, which is in a natural language or something like that, and compile it into a declarative query, okay, which I will be able to evaluate against my database. Okay, then based on whatever information I get, I will need to decide which questions, what questions to generate and ask the crowd. When I get answers from the crowd, I will need to decide how to aggregate them, how to put them together and decide whether this answer is good or not. And one of the other things that I will have to do is to select the crowd. Who should I ask what, and whether I need to personalize the question or the answer to my given user. And once I collected the information, I will need to update my my knowledge base and combine, okay, the new information that I got with the information that I have in the database. And one thing that one should keep in mind is that depending on the information that I get from the crowd, whether it's the location of something or an opinion about something, I will have to treat it differently, okay? Because the location, there is only one correct location, okay? But whether the restaurant is good or bad, there may be different opinions, and then I shouldn't just look for the correct opinion, but rather the distribution or the average or something like that, and we'll see how we do that. Okay, so until now I only told you what I want to do and what are the challenges. And what I'll do next, don't panic, I'll show you the architecture of the system that actually does that. You don't need to read that, it's very complicated. We'll go part by part and I'll explain what each part is doing, but I'll just give you the general flow, okay? Like where you start, where it ends, and what the system does in the middle, and then we'll try to learn a little bit more about each of the things, okay? So there's a user there. This is Anne at the top, okay? She's asking a question, okay? She wants to know where to take her kids in New York, etc., etc. She can do that either in the natural language, like just say the question, or through a graphical query interface, and I'll show you that in a second. And that generates a query, okay, in a formal language, and I'll show you the query language also in a second. The query goes into the query engine. Now the query engine has to execute the query and generate the answers, okay? So the query engine uses two things. First, there at the top, at the corner, there is a database, okay? The database contains all the information that I had to start with, like my database, my ontology, etc., etc., and all the information that I collected on the way, okay, answers from the crowd or more general information that I got from the crowd. So the query engine can consult with that. Based on what the query engine finds there, it decides what more information is needed from the crowd, and then this goes to the crowd task manager that actually will generate questions to the crowd. Okay, so there will be questions generated to the crowd, and the answers will come back there. There will be evaluation of whether they're correct or not, etc., etc. What more questions to ask, and so on. And there is also another component that is responsible for crowd selection. Okay, for a given question, what kind of crowd should I look for? Okay, who is the correct crowd? And that could be based on the profile of the crowd or their past answers, whether they're reliable or not, etc., etc. And the same query language actually that selects, that helps us to describe the information needs will also help us to select the crowd, and I'll talk about that. Okay, so that's kind of the general picture. And what I'll do now is kind of, unless you have questions before I'm starting, what I want to do is go part by part and tell you a little bit about the parts that I find at least more interesting. Okay, so we'll start from the database. Okay, like how do I model the information? What kind of information I have there? And then we'll go like that. Okay, so what's the knowledge repository? So the knowledge repository, the base of the knowledge repository is actually a bunch of ontologies, okay, that exist. So we're using WordNet and Foursquare and Yago, and you can plug in whatever ontology that you want. And then in addition to that initial ontologies, we will collect inside this database all the additional general knowledge that we'll get from the crowd with the trust and or error probability, and all the individual information that we get, and I'll talk about it more in a second. So just for those of you who doesn't know what an ontology is, don't be shy. I need to know how deep to go in. Okay, so think about an ontology as a graph. Okay, the nodes are the concepts that exist, okay, and they're edges that say how they relate to each other. Okay, so for instance, here the most of the edges are a subclass of or something like that. So for instance, we have something which is called an activity. There are two types of activities, feed the monkey and sport. There are different types of sports, which are water sport, biking, and ball games. And water sport, you have swimming and water polo, et cetera, et cetera. So, and the same for the restaurants. You can have all the properties of the restaurants, the different restaurants that exist, and the relationship between them. For instance, that something is nearby something else, et cetera, et cetera. So that's my database. It's all the information that I have, okay? Now, this models the data that actually resides on the disk. The data, I told you, we assume that people have a database in their brain also. So that's my, we assume that each person has a database in the head that actually records what they did, their preferences, et cetera, et cetera. So for instance, if on a specific day I visited the Bronx Zoo and ate pasta in the Pine restaurant, the way we model it is as a bunch of facts that are related to this ontology. Okay, so I visited the Bronx Zoo and I ate pasta at Pine. Okay, so these are the two facts that are relevant to this transaction. Okay, and the same for every other transaction. Okay, and as I told you, we'll see how we do it immediately. I'm gonna ask open and close questions that will extract information from that. And this will help me to enrich my ontology. So that's exactly the ontologies that we had before. So for instance, I can learn about new restaurants and the fact that Shack Shack is nearby Madison Square, for instance. Okay, so these are facts that I didn't have and I can learn about them. And the same, I can learn about preferences, okay? That people frequently eat at a specific restaurant or like something or don't like, et cetera, et cetera. Okay, so the ontology will be enriched by both general information and individual information. So that's all I wanted to say about the database. Now, let's try to understand how questions or queries are formulated. Okay, so my user will be asking something like that. Okay, and the system, I will explain later if we get to that, compiles the natural language thing into a formal language, a formal query that is asking questions about the data. So let's try to parse what's written there. You don't have to understand all the syntax, but I'll just give you a very general a description. So actually the query is composed of two parts, okay? The blue part, the part at the top, is a Sparkle query that goes and queries the ontology, okay, the database. So what's written there is I'm looking for, so I have multiple variables there, X, Y, and Z. So X is supposed to be an attraction, okay? That is inside New York. So I'm looking for attractions inside New York, okay? And Y is activity. Okay, so I'm looking for attractions inside New York and activities. And Z is a restaurant. Okay, so attractions, activities, restaurants. And I want the restaurant to be near the activity. Okay, so all this information I can find in the repository. Okay, what are the interesting, the places, the activities, the restaurant that are nearby, okay? And then once I know what are the names of the restaurants, et cetera, et cetera, the second part is the part that says, okay, for this restaurant activity and attraction, go and ask the crowd, get me information from the crowd, whether they do these things, they go to, they do this activity at this attraction, and they go to eat at that restaurant all at the same time, okay? Because there may be very good restaurants that you don't want to take your sweaty kids after they play in the park. I mean, it's a good restaurant, and playing in the park is great, they just don't go together. Okay, so what you ask is, you ask the crowd, is this combination of doing this and this and this, like I asked in my query, go well together? Okay, so again, the upper part is querying the database, and the lower part goes to the crowd and asks them questions in order to verify which from the assignments is correct. Okay, so if you think about query evaluation, the way it will work is the following. The upper part will be evaluated against the database, and then, for instance, we will find out that the Central Park is a nice place, is a place in New York, and biking is an activity that you can do there, and Mo's vegetarian is a nearby restaurant. Now, what you would like to ask the crowd is this something, is this combination good? Okay, so you will generate a question for the crowd. For instance, how often do you go biking in Central Park and then eat in Mo's vegetarian? Okay? Or for instance, you may find, and then the answer could be, okay, I do it once a month. Okay, which means 12 days out of 365 days in a year. That's kind of the frequency or the support for this pattern. Okay, or for instance, you can find another assignment, okay, Central Park and basketball, and then you can ask, how often do you play basketball in Central Park, and get a similar answer. Okay, so that's in general how the query evaluation will go. You will find the assignment, you will ask the crowd, and you will get back things, okay? Or if you look at the, like, in a more formal way, in the query there are patterns, okay, the ones with the variables, okay? And what you do is you match these patterns inside your ontology, you get assignments, and with these assignments, you generate tasks for the crowd. So for instance, you want to know whether playing baseball in Central Park is significant. And typically, you will also have a budget, how much money or how much time you want to spend on executing this crowd. Okay, and what are the user preferences? Which users should you choose for that? Okay, so that's how the system will do that. So one thing that is important to understand at this point is that when you go and match a query against a database, there may be many assignments, okay? And so in principle, like in this naive evaluation that I explained until now, you will go to the crowd and ask everything, which means you may ask for combinations that are not important, and you're going to waste a lot of energy. So what you would like... So what you would like to do, in a way, is you try to do this efficiently, okay? So the way you do it efficiently is because of the fact that you're using, that we're using an ontology, there are questions that if you ask them and you know the answer for them, you don't need to ask other questions. So for instance, if I know that people are biking frequently at Central Park, okay, then I don't need to ask anymore whether biking in a park is something that people do. Because if this happens a lot, because Central Park is a park, it means that this also happens a lot. So if I have the answer for that, I don't need to ask that. Okay? On the other hand, if I know that it's not very frequent for people to bike in Central Park, there is no point for me to ask, do you go biking at Central Park and then also play basketball at Central Park after that or at the same time? Because if this is not frequent, then definitely this is not frequent. Okay? So the way we're using this this knowledge, okay, is really in order to know where to focus our questions on one hand and where to prune the search on the other hand. I'm not going to give you the algorithm that we're using in details. I'll just give you some intuition. Okay, so what we're doing actually is we're building some sort of hierarchy of the possible assignments, okay, from very general ones to more specific ones. And then we traverse this hierarchy somehow in a top-down fashion. And once we know that something is relevant, we know that there's a point in going down. If something is not relevant, then you can prune the search, okay? So you can do that, and you can show that actually this is an optimal algorithm, and we have a full analysis of the complexity, etc., of the algorithm in the paper. I'm not going to go into that. But what I want to say actually is something a little bit deeper. Okay, so we've done a lot of work on optimization. Okay, like trying to find the best strategy or the best algorithm, and proving that it's the best. Okay, and what's the complexity of that, etc. I'm a theoretician by heart, so I do a lot of theorems, proofs, algorithm theorems, proof, complexity bounds, etc. The thing is, when you go and actually try to implement the system using the algorithm that you proved that is optimal, the performance sucks. And why is that? The thing is that people have an opinion, okay? So for instance, the algorithm can tell you that the best way, the optimal way to find the answer is first to ask about that, then to ask about that, and then to ask about that. That's the optimal way, okay? But people get irritated when you ask them about different things. They just don't want to answer because it's context switching and they don't like it, okay? What they do like is to stay in context, okay? If you ask them about sport, then you should ask them afterwards about baseball and not about spaghetti, okay? And if you ask them about baseball, then you can ask about something related, okay? So the optimal algorithm is not necessarily one that is convenient or nice for people, okay? So what we had to do actually is to take all these things that people like or don't like in terms of interaction into consideration when we design the best strategy to find the solution. So for instance, some of the things that we figured out was that, okay, when you ask people concrete questions, once in a while you have to ask them an open question because they want to say what they think. Okay, so you have to, even if your algorithm, you know, tells you these are the three specific questions that you should ask, still, plug in an open question, they will be happy, your users. Okay, also, even if your algorithm tells you that it's best to switch from here to there to there, don't do that. Try to bring the user from here to there by a sequence of logical questions that are kind of semantically related. Otherwise, they will hate it. Also, something that you should do, for instance, some people, you ask them, do you go to a Chinese restaurant and then go play? Or do you go to Chinese restaurant and then do that? Do you go to Chinese restaurant and then do that? But maybe they don't like Chinese food at all, okay? So you should give them a way to say, all this line of questions is irrelevant for me, okay? So it's like cross for a big part of the questions. And there are other aspects of the algorithm that I haven't discussed, which is parallelism and quality assurance, etc. But we'll get to that a little bit after that. Okay, so far we covered the database and the query language. I want to talk just for a second about quality of answers, etc. I will not go into that. If you're interested, we can talk about it afterwards, but just to give intuition for those of you that are not from crowdsourcing on how this is done. So for instance, suppose I want to ask the crowd how often they play baseball in Central Park. Okay, so typically you will have a budget for that. You will say, okay, I'm willing to pay at least at most this and this, or I'm willing to pay to ask at most 500 questions or 50 questions or whatever. And then the questions will be generated. And you will start going and ask people, okay? So you may get different different answer. Answer one will be never, and then another answer maybe once a week, etc. So you will have to take all these answers, and you will need to aggregate them, okay? So here comes a big difference between general information and individual information. In individual information, how often do you play baseball in Central Park? There's no one correct answer, right? There are many answers, okay? And typically what you would like to do is to find the average, okay? So the thing is, you start asking questions, and how do you know that you've asked enough or that the answers that you get are representative, okay? So what typically, what you will try to do is you will try to estimate, you will treat the answers that you get as a sample, okay, typically out of uniform distribution, and you will try to estimate the error, okay, the mean, okay, first of all, what's the average, and what's the error that there is on this average, okay, and then you will try, you will need to estimate how this error, okay, will shrink or increase if you ask one more question. Okay, like you will need to estimate based on the answers that you got already what might be a new answer and how it will affect your distribution and error. Okay, so that's what you will do, and that's how you will decide whether it's beneficial or not to ask one more question. Okay, so that's for the individual information. For the general data, you will have to use very different technique, because there you don't want the average, you want the correct answer. Okay, so you will have to try to weigh the user by expertise, to remove outliers, etc. I'm not going to go into that, but that there's a lot of research in this area that focuses on exactly how to do all this, all these things. Before I move on, I want to say something about the user interface, just a little bit. I showed you a query language, okay, that described Anne's query. But the thing is, you know, when I go to New York with my kids, I don't want to write an SQL or a Sparkle query, right? It's a bit complicated. And also, you don't expect a naive user to do that. So if you want people to actually use this system or actually use this model, you should give them a nicer user interface. So the first user interface that we started with was actually a graphical user interface where you could select the entities that you wanted, and we had nice pictures from Flickr that so everything was graphical and very nice, and you could say what are the relationships that you're interested in between the entities, etc. And that was very nice. We thought it was very nice because for us, it looked much nicer than a query, formal query language. But if you try to do this, to give this graphical user interface to a naive user that is not a database or computer science person, there is no way they can work with that. It's way too complicated, even though it's graphical and nice and has pictures, and we think it's great. Okay, so what we did, the next thing that we did was actually work on a natural language translator that took questions in a natural language and actually generate formal queries out of that. And I want to tell you just a little bit about this thing. Okay, so let's look at this query, for example, or at this question. Okay, so suppose I'm going to I got warning that they will leave it for. That's okay. Suppose we want to, I'm not going now to New York, but I'm going to Buffalo, and what I want to do, I have, an afternoon which is free, and I'm looking for the most interesting places near Forest Hill, Buffalo, that I would visit in the fall. Okay, so these are the things that I'm interested in. And again, if you look at this question, there are two types of information. Okay, the places near Buffalo, Forest Hotel in Buffalo. Okay, these are the places, you can find it in the database or like in a map or whatever. And the things that are most interesting and should be visited in the fall, this is individual information. Okay, so if I want to take this question and translate it into my query language, you have to realize that I need to identify these two parts. Why is it important that I identify these two parts? Because the blue part that asks the database should go in the query language to the upper part, right? While the red stuff that talks about the individual information, it's actually the part that goes in the lower part of the query. Okay, so in order to do the mapping from the question to the query language, I need to be able to split these two types of information, and that's actually not trivial. Okay, so what I would need to do in order to do the translation, I will need to split these two things. Okay, I will need to translate each one into the syntax, okay, of the upper part and the lower part, and then put the two things together into one query. Okay, generate one query out of these two components. Okay, so how can I do that? Okay, so let's try before I illustrate how we actually do that. Maybe I should give you a little bit intuition of what tools exist. Okay, what people have already done in this area that I could use. Okay, so for the first thing, distinguishing between the general and the individual information, there is a lot of work. Is it readable? Yeah, okay. So there is a lot of work on opinion mining. Okay, it's work that takes text and try to understand from within the text whether the opinion on the thing is positive, negative, whether, they take a review, the text that you wrote in a review, and they try to say, is this review positive? Is this review negative? Okay, or what part of the review shows that this is positive and negative? So in principle, I could maybe use this kind of work in order to find in my query the things that are opinions, okay? But this doesn't cover everything because my queries, they're not only about opinion, do I think it's good or bad, but also about habits of people, what they do frequently or not, and that's not covered by this kind of work, okay? Something else that I could do, okay, is say, the blue things in the question, the things that are from the database, okay, they should appear in the ontology. So what I could do actually is another way to distinguish between the individual and the general information, and is try to check each word if it appears, or each concept in the query, whether it appears in the ontology or not. Okay? So that could be a way to find things that are not in the ontology, but this also is confusing because sometimes there are words that may appear both in the ontology, but still are opinion, okay, or still are talking about the frequency or things like that, and that's very confusing. And actually, we experimented with that, and we saw that that's not a great way to go. So we needed to develop new technology to do that. So I'll tell you in a second how we do that. But suppose you know how to identify things, then you need to translate. Okay, so again, there has been a lot of work on translating questions in a natural language into Sparkle, into XQuery, into SQL, into all these things. So why can't we just use that? Okay, so most of these works actually are using the fact that the question that you're asking is about a database. So they match between the free text and the schema of the database or the ontology or whatever. But in our case, much of the information that we're asking about is opinions and stuff like that are not in the database. So you cannot use standard tools, okay? You have to work a bit harder. So I'll show you how our system works. I'm not going to go into the details. I think we're already, I consumed a lot of your time. But so the way the system works is as follows. What it's going to do is it will, first of all, take the query and try to identify inside the question, okay, the individual parts, okay? And then it will take them out, okay? It will split, actually, the text into the things that are asked about the database and things that are asked about opinion and individual things, okay? Now, for the things that are relevant to the database, what we are going to use is standard tools, okay? The tools that I've mentioned before that just take query in natural language on a database and translate it to a question on the database, okay? And for the individual things, we will use a translation of our own that we developed. And then we will take the two parts of the query, the blue part and the red part, and we'll assemble them together, okay? So the way that we are going to find who are the individual patterns and so on, we're going to use vocabularies that will tell us, okay, this is individual, this is not, and so on. And then for the translation of the general part of the query, we use a system which is called Freya that translates standards, general questions into Sparkle. And then there we generated our own translation and we composed things together. And I think the only thing I want to mention is that what you put as input to the system is the text parsed by a standard parser. And then you get out a query which you run using the system that I showed you before. I think I'm going to skip the details of the... Just a second. Keeping a few slides. Okay. So the last thing that I want to talk about is the selection of the crowd. Okay, so I talked about the upper parts, everything there, and the last part that I want to cover is how you select the crowd for the query. And the thing is that what we want to do is what is very natural, okay? How do you select a crowd to answer a particular query, okay? So maybe the user told you, okay? He gave you some things to start with. He told you, okay, I want the people to answer this question that there will be people from New York or from Hong Kong or that they will like something or not like something or something like that. So the user may say, these are my requirements. Okay, but also you may want to select user by expertise. Okay, you may want to look at their past behavior. Okay, and say, okay, users that behave like that are good ones for this thing or bad ones for this thing. And the last thing is maybe you want similarity. If I'm asking about a nice place to go with my kids in New York, you would like people like me to answer. Okay, because if I don't like sports, then you shouldn't recommend to me sport, which is something that sportive people, for instance, would recommend. Okay, so you want the three things together. Okay, so again, suppose I have Anne is traveling all over the world. So now she's going to Australia and she goes to Australia in January. And she looks for a recommended surfing beach near Sydney, okay? That's what she wants to do. That's the so the natural language questions was translated into a query to the system, which actually says, okay, find interesting places near Sydney, okay? And find places near Sydney and ask people, okay, whether it makes sense to go surfing there in January. Okay, so this is find places near Sydney, and this is ask people whether we should go surfing there. Okay, so what kind of people should I ask this question? Any intuition? Maybe people that live somewhere near Sydney and that like surfing, right? And also maybe people that are similar to Anne. Okay, if she likes surfing of a particular kind, maybe if these people like same things, then you should ask them. Okay, so here are the resources that I'm going to use. Okay, I'm going to use Anne's profile and the profile of the other people. Okay, so for instance, in Anne's profile is written that she lives in Paris. Okay, that she's a female, that she likes photography and bird watching, and she graduated from NYU. Okay, that's the profile of Anne. And then there's Bill that lives in Sydney. He's a male. He likes photography. So you can already see that we haven't said exactly how we will specify it, but he's a good candidate because he lives near Sydney and he likes photography and Anne likes photography also. So they're kind of similar, right? He lives in the right place and he's not very far from her, okay? And there is also Carol that lives also in Sydney. She's female, so in a way maybe she's similar at least in gender, and she likes art. Not photography necessarily, but art in general. So she's close, but not that close, okay? So that's about the profiles. Now we can also see, not just the profile, but if we say, let us look at answers that they answered before, okay? To other questions that the system might have asked them, okay? So for instance, Anne said that she likes doing sport, okay? Like her answer was, do you like sport? Yes, I like it. And she likes surfing, and she likes surfing and Santa Cruz, and she also plays volleyball. Okay, so again, forget the syntax, just go with me for the things that we have there. And Bill, he also likes sports and surfing, and he likes surfing at the Wanda Beach in January, okay? And he likes also playing volleyball. So again, if we look at the similarity between them, okay, so they both of them like surfing, okay? And then both of them like volleyball, okay? And then there is Carol that she likes sport, she likes surfing. She also likes surfing in general in another beach, and she likes drawing. Okay, so again, similar but a little bit less, okay? So this is the information that I have about them, their profile, and their history interaction with the system, the things they like, the things they preferred, etc. And what I would like to do is actually write a query, okay? Or I would like actually to generate automatically a query from the query of the question that will say, don't read all this thing, I'll explain, okay? That will say who are the right users, okay? So just let's, before we read the syntax, okay, let's just look at the yellow stuff. So the yellow stuff says, the things with the yellow squares, they just say what kind of database or information we're using. So we're using the ontology, we're using the profile, and trans is the transactions, it's the answers that I collected so far. Okay, so this is what I will use. And if we try to summarize what's written there, okay, so this part says, I'm looking for crowd members that live in Sydney and surf frequently. Okay, so I'm from the profile of the people, I would like to know whether they live near Sydney and then whether they surf. The question, they answer the question, do you surf with the support greater than something? Okay, so these are the people that live near Sydney and surf frequently. Okay, and I also want these people to be similar to Anne. Okay, so I want them to have a profile in general that is not very far from Anne, and also the answers that they answered before, not so far from Anne. Okay, so we have this construct in the language, which is called similar, that checks the similarity between profiles and the similarity between answers. Okay, I'm not going to explain exactly how this is done, but you can think about precision and recall, like how many things they do the same and how many things they do differently. Okay, and also what I want is that they surf near Sydney in January, and the places near Sydney I'm going to take from the ontology. Okay? All right? So, again, I'm not going to go into all the details of the query language, but you can see the analogy between the query and the user selection, okay? The query was about January, blah, 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 and the user selection says, okay, I want people that surf in that place in January, but I also want them to be relevant in the sense that they live in the area, they are similar to Anne, both in the profile and in the answers that they had before, okay? So that's actually a piece of work that we're working on right now. We're building the query evaluation mechanism for this kind of queries and also the inference from the question of the user in automatically into this kind of queries that select the users, okay? All right. To conclude, so I showed you this architecture. I tried to go over the different parts. I hope I didn't bore you too much. I think what we like about this architecture is not just that it's our architecture of our system, but the fact that it actually allows, if you look at all the crowdsourcing papers that you find in the recent conferences, you actually can match each piece of work to one component in this architecture. So in a way, this tells us that this is a good architecture because really it captures all the different components of the systems that exist. Okay, so we couldn't find a paper that doesn't match like a particular box there or boxes that were not discussed in any paper. Okay, so somehow it gives a nice picture. Okay, I will conclude here. I think my conclusion for this thing is that the crowd is an incredible resource, and this is a citation that I really like by Pablo Picasso. He says that many years ago, he said that computers are useless because they can only give you answers, okay? And I think crowdsourcing actually turns the thing around because it makes computer ask questions, and it's really nice. And in general, in this area, there are tons of challenges. The computation is interactive. There's tons of data. There's varying quality and trust. And you have to deal with all these things. And it's very challenging. And it's a lot of fun. And before I conclude, I want to say thank you to all my students, collaborators, et cetera, that worked on this system. There is no way I could do any of this work without them. So that's it. And thank you for listening.
Just now you mentioned the user selection is based on the user transaction, right? Where the user transactions are come from? This is the history answer data or something?
Yeah,
else?
So currently it's the history of the interaction of users with the system. So the answer is the answer to previous questions. Okay, like when, yes, but in principle you could extract it from other resources also, from what they put on Facebook, from tweets they did, but that's another research, how you extract this information and put it into the system. But currently, it's the history of interacting with the system, which is fairly standard because also, for instance, in Amazon Mechanical Turk, you look at the answers that people answer, then you say, okay, this person is reliable, this is not. So actually, one thing that we did is we tried to look at all the work that did user selection, like algorithms for user selection, and we tried to express the criteria using our query language, like to see whether we can capture it. And in general, we can, like from at least
it's a great idea. And at the very beginning of the lecture, you just mentioned for further usage, maybe we can store the answer in a knowledge base or something. Is there any difference between general knowledge in knowledge base and individual knowledge in knowledge base as a managed part?
So for general knowledge, you would want to keep something like trust. Do you think the answer is correct? Okay. And for individual knowledge, there is no correct and incorrect. So something, what you would like to keep is maybe the idea of the user that gave you so that you know something about correlation between, like if you look at about the distribution or something like that, and what kind of users said that and what kind of users say that. So I think that's a little bit different than...
Maybe it may be stored in a different format, right?
Yeah. It's an ontology data, but everything is RDF, okay? It's the same data model. It's just the question is, what is it that you keep?
Thank you.
Well, first, thanks for your impressive talk. And actually, I have one question about the press part. I think you can go to the previous slides. And about that, for a query, you have different parts, like different significant patterns. So for each kind of pattern, so you want to tell whether it's significant or not. So it's based on the measure, right, the function, so the expected.
That was
$5.
Yeah.
So this budget is for this whole set, right?
In this case, the budget is for an individual, for resolving this individual task.
Yes. So when do you stop to ask when you run out of the budget or when you think that the pattern is significant enough?
So our estimation works as follows. So we look at the probability. So we estimate that something is significant if we think that it's more than half, 50% that it is significant, okay? So that's our current estimation, okay? And then we estimate if we ask more questions, how this confidence will change. Okay, so if I see that by asking, you know, one question or two questions, this will change a lot, like go down or go up, then there is a point in asking, okay? And but on the other hand, even if I still have budget, but I see that, you know, asking a little bit more will not change much, then there's no point in spending this budget. I can save it somehow. So I will not necessarily exploit the budget until the end, but I will say, okay, if I'm certain enough, then that's good enough for me.
So it's mainly based on this measure instead of the budget, right?
Yeah.
So how do you split the budget? Because for a long query, you have different parts.
Yeah.
Different parts, you have different significant patterns. So for a long query, you have a budget. So how do you split the budget to this part or this part?
So actually we do it, okay, so we fix a budget, that is kind of estimation. What's a normal budget that you need in order to ask one individual question, okay? And then we start using that as efficiently as we can, okay? And then depending of what other questions we need to ask, we're going to use more, and we may run out of budget, okay? So because the point is that on one hand, you cannot use too little budget per individual question because then the answer will not be meaningful, okay? So you have to spend at least something. And then when you ask more and more, again, when you run out of budget, there is nothing you can do, so you will return that answer. So it's not perfect. Okay, it's not, but you do the best that you can with your given budget.
Where do you plan on using this algorithm?
What do you mean where?
I mean, there are a lot of crowdsourcing applications, and this is really a nice way to use the semantic analysis in a more ontological way. But I'm trying to understand, is the social trend actually shifting towards such a crowdsourcing information exchange? Or do we want more instantaneous answers?
Okay, so it's true that there is no way you can answer that instantaneously, okay? I'm asking where to go with my kids in New York. If I really want to consult the crowd, this is not real-time thing. But even today, people are using forums, right? You post a question in a forum and you wait, okay? So what we can show is that you will wait less time and get better results if you do that.
Okay.
Okay, so that, again, I'm not saying forms are meaningless, etc. You would like to use the answers that are already there also and get them. But if you want new questions and new answers, then if we manage to build a form application that is used by enough people, etc., that is based on this technology, it will be much better.
Okay, I understand. Thank you.
Hello, Professor. I want to ask about that your system only returns one answer to one question.
No.
Oh, so is it available for the requester to specify the number of answers they want?
Yes. So actually in the syntax right now, we have a threshold. Like you say, I want things that are with that high preference or with that quality or with that. So it's everything above the threshold. Okay, so I'm looking for a good restaurant in New York. Okay, so I'm saying when I say good, I mean, you know, in a rank between 1 to 5, everything above 4. Okay, so I will get all the restaurants that people recommend that have either score 5 or 4, even if there are many of those.
So this value is set by the requester or the system?
It's something that the requester said. It's part of the query specification. I can show you, you see there is with support. Okay, so that's the construct in the formal language. Okay?
Thank you.
Anybody ask question in this area? No?
You're done. Otherwise, you have to come down and take the microphone yourself.
Okay, so since no more questions, please join me to thank Professor Milo's excellent talk. Thank you.